Okay. Good evening and welcome to Cambridge Forum, this hardy crew who came out after the blizzard of 2013. I'm Pat Zirke, director of Cambridge Forum, and I am delighted to welcome you tonight to this very special program. Usually Cambridge Forum is about talk, but tonight we're about music, the music of the banjo, America's quintessential instrument. So before we begin, I want to take care of a few housekeeping details. There is information about Cambridge Forum and its support organization, the Friends of Cambridge Forum, on the table in the foyer where you came in. There is also a list to which you can add your name, your address, your email address, if you would like information about our future programs. You can also take a copy of the Hot Off the Press Winter-Spring 2013 program schedule. You can take it with you tonight. Very important that you check out the information about our friends. It is thanks to the generosity of the Friends of Cambridge Forum that we've been presenting these public programs in Harvard Square for 46 years. So you are all friends or potential friends, and we do welcome your support. I hope on your way in, you all picked up a copy of the banjo quiz. Listen for the answers during the program. There is no guarantee that every question will be answered, so I know you'll be curious, and to satisfy your curiosity, we do have an answer sheet, and you'll be able to pick one of those up on your way out. We also have copies of the DVD of the Banjo Project, the PBS, well, Give Me the Banjo, the PBS documentary that Mark Fields has created out of the larger Banjo Project. And we have copies of Tony Trischka's CDs for sale here at the table in front. And I'm sure that they will be happy to sign copies for you either at intermission or after the program. Our format is a little bit different for those of you who are familiar with our regular format. We will start out with the Banjo Project. We'll immerse ourselves in it, and then we'll have an intermission, and then we'll come back to the Banjo Project and finish up in a rousing fashion. As you know, our public programs are recorded and then edited and broadcast as National Public Radio broadcasts. Tonight's program is also being videotaped, and it will be a webcast on the WGBH Forum Network. And so because our program, you will have a chance to ask some questions at the end of the program. So if you have questions, when you ask them, please come forward and use that microphone at the head of the center aisle so that your question in your voice is recorded as well as the answers. So we record everything except one thing. And you know what that is, the ringing of your cell phone or other electronic device. So this is the perfect time for you to turn them off or at least silence them. And while you're doing that, as soon as you've done that, we'll start. Okay, so welcome to the Banjo Project, a special Cambridge Forum presentation featuring performances by banjo virtuoso Tony Trischka, assisted by Daryl Anger on fiddle and Mark Fields as narrator. Tony Trischka has been called the most influential banjo player in the roots music world. His avant-garde banjo stylings have inspired a whole generation of progressive bluegrass musicians. In 2007, he received an International Bluegrass Music Association Award for Banjo Player of the Year. His recording, Double Banjo Bluegrass Spectacular, received awards for Recorded Event of the Year, Instrumental Album of the Year, and a Grammy nomination. Over the course of his career, Trischka has performed with a who's who of spectacular musicians, including Pete Seeger, Mike Seeger, Earl Scruggs, Bill Evans, Bill Keith, Bruce Molsky, Bella Fleck, and Steve Martin. Daryl Anger has made a 30-plus year career as one of the most influential and innovative fiddlers in the world. He developed his signature voice, working with some of the world's great improvising string musicians, among them Stefan Grappelli, Mark O'Connor, David Griesman, Tony Rice, Bella Fleck, and Vassar Clements. Known for versatility and depth, his work includes recordings, videos, and books of jazz originals and arrangements, and traditional derived music in many styles. Mark Fields, our narrator, is a writer, producer, and director of arts and cultural documentaries and the winner of 5 regional Emmys for his work on PBS. In November 2011, his 90-minute music history, Give Me the Banjo, narrated by Steve Martin, had its national PBS premiere. The documentary is part of a larger project focused on the instrument, and you can find out more at the website www.thebanjoproject.org. Previously, Mark wrote the scripts for 2 episodes of the Emmy-winning 6-part PBS series Broadway, The American Musical, and as writer-producer, Willie the Lion, a musical biography of the forgotten jazz giant, Willie the Lion Smith, featuring Artie Shaw, Dr. Billy Taylor, and Dick Hyman. If any musical instrument can be said to be quintessentially American, it is the banjo. Even its construction, it tells a story of cultural exchange. The banjo is a drum with strings, a symbolic blending of African and European musical identities. How has this musical instrument come to represent so much of America's social history? And how does its music speak to so many of the issues at the heart of American culture today? Let's let the music speak for itself. Welcome Tony Trischka, Daryl Anger, and Mark Fields.
Give me the banjo, wrote Mark Twain in 1865. When you want genuine music, music that will come right home to you like a bad quarter, suffuse your system like strychnine whiskey, ramify your whole constitution like the measles, and break out on your hide like the pin feather pimples on a picked goose. When you want all this, just smash your piano and invoke the glory beaming banjo. I hear that it's a good idea to start with a quotation from Mark Twain if you want to be taken seriously when talking about American culture. So I invoke Mark Twain as a way of signaling that it's time to take the banjo seriously. This evening, we're exploring one of several possible pathways through banjo history, following the twisted journey of the five string. It's based on the work Tony Trischka and I have done on the Banjo Project and our PBS documentary, Give Me the Banjo, that aired in 2011. The banjo tells the story of 300 years of cultural borrowings, exchanges, thefts, and collisions. In that time, it's been a black instrument, a white instrument, a laborer's pastime, and a woman's diversion, a young person's fad, and an old-timer's friend. But mostly, it's been a snubbed instrument. There are probably more jokes about the banjo than any other instrument. It's been a stereotype from its beginnings on this continent. And every time you pick up the banjo, you're picking up on issues of race, class, region, and the tension between folk and pop culture. In a music publication from the 1880s, I came across a statement about the banjo that sums up its history, before and since. Probably no instrument has had to fight its way through such bitter antagonism as the banjo. For many years, people tended to think of the banjo only as a happy or silly instrument. But the reality is that ever since its arrival in the New World, the banjo has been an instrument of raw emotions. Not just joy, love, and pleasure, but also sorrow, loss, and pain. Steve Martin describes the sound of the banjo as simultaneously joyful and melancholy, deeply moving and emotional in its duality. Beneath the masks and stereotypes, we can still hear traces of where it really comes from. As Thomas Jefferson noted, the instrument proper to them is the banjar, which they brought hither from Africa. By them, Jefferson meant the enslaved Africans, including those working on his plantation. By the time Jefferson made his observations, white folks had been noticing the banjo for at least a century. Jefferson's contemporary wrote this from Carlisle Bay, Jamaica in 1796. A slave ship belonging to North America and bound to Savannah in Georgia has arrived from the coast of Guinea and lying very near to us with a cargo of Negroes on board. In the daytime, they were not allowed to remain in place where they had slept, but were mostly kept on the deck where they were made to exercise. The captain wanted the slaves to dance, but they did not seem disposed to comply with his wish. He began to dance himself by way of setting them an example, but they showed no inclination to follow it till the cat was called for. Then, indeed, also encouraged by the music of their beloved banjar, they began to sing and skip about. A few, however, were content to have the cat smartly applied across their shoulders several times before they would so much belie their feelings as to make merry when their hearts were sad. The banjo was an African instrument when it came here. It became an African-American instrument here. It met with the fiddle and eventually began being played by European Americans. From its earliest sightings in the Caribbean, the banjo was linked to dancing. Black slaves and indentured whites reportedly provided music at dances in Virginia and Maryland. The fiddle-banjo duo spread throughout the Blue Ridge and Piedmont regions and points west and south along the Great Valley Road. Wherever a banjo got together with a fiddle, they set listeners' feet to dancing. Where cultures collide, there is love and theft. Strangers become neighbors, and through the music, exchanges occur. Black fiddlers also learned Anglo-Celtic tunes. At the same time, the black banjo players began to develop ways of playing those tunes on the banjo. Now, if you take an African-American instrument with its African roots and you add to it the Celtic musical traditions and the Western European musical traditions that these white performers had, what you wind up with is something that's totally new, that comes together for the first time and makes something uniquely American. It was only a matter of time before an enterprising white would capitalize on this novelty. Joel Walker Sweeney did just that. Born in Appomattox, Virginia around 1810, Sweeney started on fiddle but heard the half-barbaric twang of the banjo played by his neighbor's slaves and learned from them how to play it. Legend has it that he killed the family cat for its skin and that his mother was so upset that she smashed his first banjo. After gaining a reputation playing in the Lynchburg area, he made a name for himself in the circus as a blackface song and dance man. He popularized a new design for the banjo, using a hoop frame instead of a gourd, adding a bass string, not the thumb string, but keeping the downstroke percussive style and the tone that could both grumble and ring. When Sweeney first appeared in New York City in 1839, his authentic-sounding plantation songs and playing style made him into one of the hottest tickets on the Bowery stage. All the performers who had been doing blackface all of a sudden want to play banjo. My friend, the banjoist and author Bob Carlin, calls it the first big bang for the banjo. Within months, dozens of minstrel troupes are touring the U.S. Sweeney and the Virginia Minstrels go to England. The demand for banjos and minstrel music is so great that banjos are mass manufactured. Banjo players are in demand as teachers. They write instruction manuals. A popular blackface banjo player named Tom Briggs was one of the first. Did not live to see his manual published, catching typhoid fever on the way to California. In 1855, the New York Times ran a lengthy obituary, a measure of the celebrity and rising social status of the banjo minstrel. The detailed account of Briggs on his deathbed was told in the hushed, stirring tones usually reserved for a dying hero. Poor Tom Briggs. How well I recollect him as he used to enter between the first and second divisions of the performance with his banjo on his shoulder and his cheerful, "Good evening, white folks." He was the dandy Negro, clean as a racehorse, fine as a star, and when his fingers struck the banjo, you felt that he was filled with the spirit of an artist. An hour before he went, he asked me to hand him the banjo. He took hold of it and looked at it for a minute as if he was looking at a person he was going to part with forever. He tried to hit it, but he could only drop the weight of his thin fingers on the chords. There was no stroke to his touch at all. He could just barely make a sound. He dropped his hand. Then he looked at me as if he understood everything in the world and, shaking his head, said, "It's no use. Hang it up. I cannot hit it anymore." These were the last words that poor Tom Briggs ever spoke. The banjo comes into American popular music in the period of the early 1840s with players like Dan Emmett and Joel Walker Sweeney. They were both, we could say, a very early example of white boys playing the blues. Just as a century later, Eric Clapton or Jeff Beck or Jimmy Page in Britain learned to play black music from listening to recordings of black musicians, Joe Sweeney and Dan Emmett in the 1840s learned to play the banjo from black musicians. The minstrel show became the most popular form of entertainment from roughly 1840 till the end of the century. It was huge, and so was the commensurate imagery. The banjo became the minstrel's key prop, the image of slave life, along with other black caricatures, eating watermelons, carrying razors, and looking like buffoons. The banjo was part of the degrading and trivializing stereotype. But at the same time, the minstrel show transformed the banjo from a black folk instrument into the new must-have icon of pop culture.
So far the style of banjo that I've been playing has been called the stroke style, very popular in the minstrel era. And it's what's known as sometimes the stroke style or the downstroke style, because you're picking down. And that's very much the African influence. That kind of a sound there, which you hear in the fiddle shuffle that you still hear today in bluegrass. But around 1865, a man named Frank Converse put out a banjo book, and on page 38 of that book, he described the guitar style of banjo playing, which is really what we today call finger picking. And the very first tune in that section of the book was a tune called the New York March. And so I'll play the New York March for you right now. And again, this is the very first tune ever to be in a book dealing with finger picking.
Thank you.
After the Civil War, the banjo made the leap from the saloon to the salon and from blackface to black tie. Banjo makers like A.C. Fairbanks and S.S. Stewart designed ornate instruments intended for respectable men and women to play in parlors, college banjo clubs, and concert halls. The once humble slave instrument became a leisure class trophy, a marvel of modern technology and conspicuous consumption. From the New York Sun, 1880, banjos are booming now, said Mr. Henry C. Dobson, the noted teacher and banjoist. They are becoming all the rage. People used to talk and think of the banjo as appropriate only to the minstrel hall, and the idea that this instrument would become a fashionable favorite would have been ridiculed. Joel Chandler Harris, best known for his Br'er Rabbit stories, observed, "The banjo savors strongly of the plantations through which the back streets of New York City run." A rather subtle and cryptic comment, I think, on the whitewashing of the banjo's black origins. That was called Spanish Fandango, an advertisement from 1896. There is a far better way of elevating an instrument than to play difficult music on it. Take it into good company and keep it there. The more refined and intellectual the company, the better it will be. The advance of the banjo began when it was taken up by the ladies. One famous Boston banjoist, Caroline Nichols, said, "What makes me boil to the roots of my hair is to say that we play like girls. We do not. We play like musicians. There is no sex in music." Obviously, they didn't watch last night's Grammys. By the ladies, the banjo was introduced into the home circle. In fact, in 1901, the Boston-based banjo maker A.C. Fairbanks called his new banjo the White Lady, spelled W-H-Y-T-E-L-A-Y-D-I-E. So I suppose he could claim that all the leading banjo artists of the day played with white ladies. But reinventing the instrument itself wasn't enough. The purveyors of refinement had to reinvent the music and how it should be played. They called their style classic, but it really caught the public fancy when they played ragtime. That was called Dill Pickles or Dill Pickle Rag. Just when refined banjo managed to clean off the stain of burnt cork and its plantation black origins, the lure of underworld associations came strutting back in the guise of ragtime recordings, cakewalks, and coon songs. Leading one African-American journalist to ask, what with coon songs, banjo picking, and cakewalks, the white people are picking up what the better class of colored people are trying to get away from. Are the white people degenerating their tastes? Inquiring minds want to know. Thank you, sirs. That was quite refined. There were those who still wanted to keep it raw. Gus Cannon and Uncle Dave Macon were banjo-playing songsters whose long careers linked white and black folk styles, including the blues, with minstrelsy and the popular music of the 1920s. Some of you baby boomers out there may recall a top 40 hit from 1963 by the Rooftop Singers called Walk Right In. The Rooftop's founder, Eric Darling, who replaced Pete Seeger in the Weavers, wanted to record an obscure jug band tune, and he had no idea that the author was still alive. Walk Right In was originally recorded by Gus Cannon and his Jug Stompers some 35 years earlier. Not long before the song appeared on the charts, an ailing Gus Cannon had pawned his banjo in order to buy coal to heat his house. While it's an all too common story in the annals of popular music, there is so much more to Gus Cannon than this sad scenario. Gus Cannon embodied the cultural crossroads that was Memphis, his home base from around World War I. The son of a sharecropper and former slave, Cannon grew up in the heart of blues country at the height of Jim Crow. From 1914 until the early 1930s, Gus Cannon toured with the Medicine Shows throughout the Cotton South. He made a name for himself as Banjo Joe, billed as the colored champion banjo pugilist of the world. Banjoists, blackface comedians, and blues singers were favored entertainments in the doctor's shows, and Cannon could do it all. He recorded 28 sides under his own name with the Jug Stompers and was a popular entertainer in Memphis throughout the 20s and 30s. Perhaps because he played banjo, he's underappreciated as an important early blues pioneer. And now, a few words from Judge George Hay, MC of the Grand Ole Opry.
And now, friends, we present Uncle Dave making the Dixie Doodop with his plug hat, gold teeth, chin whiskers, gate guitar collar, and that million-dollar Tennessee smile. Let's go, Uncle Dave!
I'm a big fan of Uncle Dave Makin. I think it's interesting to see where he sits in the history of the instrument. He was raised in Nashville in the 1880s, where his parents ran a boarding house, and they catered to minstrel and vaudeville entertainers. But when his father was stabbed to death near the hotel, the family moved to the farm. So David Makin absorbed three distinct banjo traditions: the rural white folk, the black folk, and the minstrel vaudeville stage. He didn't become a professional performer, however, until age 50, when automobiles put his mule-drawn moving wagon out of business. Pete Seeger said, "I look upon Uncle Dave as one of the most important people in the history of American music. If somebody's writing a history of this continent, you'd have music coming from Ireland, England, and Africa, and it all got tangled up here. And it's people like Uncle Dave who were able to synthesize it." A Hollywood producer described Uncle Dave as follows: "I never met a more natural man in my life. He prays at the right time, and he cusses at the right time, and his jokes are as cute as the Dickens." But he also had a religious and sentimental side. And Tony's going to play one of Uncle Dave's few purely instrumental compositions. It's called Uncle Dave's Beloved Solo. Uncle Dave was one of the original stars of the Grand Ole Opry, and his humor, down-home wisdom, and showmanship defined the banjo's image. In late 1945, a 20-year-old showed up backstage at the Ryman, said his name was Earl Scruggs, and he said he was there to play with Bill Monroe. He started picking to warm up, and his playing drew a crowd of Opry performers. Somebody asked Uncle Dave what he thought of the kid. He said, "Well, he sure can pick the banjo, but he ain't a darn bit funny." Yeah. When we come back, the founding fathers of modern banjo, Pete and Earl. But first, here's a little taste of what rescued the five string from cultural oblivion.
Thank you.
So we're going to take a break. There's a table full of merch over there, DVDs, CDs. Check it out. We'll see you in a little bit.